this is your first time ever listening to Inspired Overflow, or maybe you might just actually be watching us live on Facebook, I want to welcome you. Here at the Inspired Overflow Radio Show, our entire purpose is to really point the way up to Jesus Christ. And so we do that by inviting different guests, men and women of God, to share their wonderful stories of faith. And then every now and again, we bring some teachers, those that are called with the gift of teaching, to help equip us to better point the way to Jesus Christ. And so I'm excited about our guest. She is no stranger to us here on the Inspired Overflow Radio Show. Some of you guys may remember her. A couple of months ago, she was on and she was teaching on how to understand the 8 prayer watches. And that is actually now available on our YouTube page. And so I want to let you guys know that if you ever miss any of our broadcasts, you can connect with us on YouTube and just look up the Inspired Overflow Radio Show and watch our archived broadcast on our YouTube page. But I want to reintroduce and welcome back to the Inspired Overflow Radio Show, Dr. Shirleas Washington.
Well, hello. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, wonderful. I'm so glad that you are here. And I know that today is kind of special. I know that you're grandmother, but you have a grandchild that should be here any day now.
Due today, so we'll see if she graces us with her presence.
Yes. So we are so excited that you are here for another. All right, that you are here for another broadcast of the Inspired Overflow Radio Show. And so I want to jump in because today we're going to be talking about how do I worship?
Yes.
And I brought you on and we're just going to have a conversation about worship.
All right.
Worship is one of the key words that God gave me for 2019. And even though I grew up in the church, got saved as a young girl, I found myself in my 30s asking God, how do I worship?
Yes.
How do I worship you?
Yes.
You know, God, what does that look like? How do I actually worship? So I'm going to just lob this question to you.
Yeah.
What is worship?
Well, worship, just the plain definition, is adoration, reverence, honor, and devotion. It's our devotion to God. And there are many, many elements and acts of worship. And I think in the church, we get caught up on the acts of worship, the elements of worship, what we do, how we put together an order of service, and all of the things that we do in the name of the Lord for the kingdom, to build the church. All of those are acts and elements of worship. But how do we personally worship? I got 4 points for you today.
Okay.
I love it.
And I'm glad that you got the points, because I want the viewers, those that are listening and those that are watching us live on Facebook, to understand that really one of your graces is that you are a teacher. You taught in the secular world and you teach now. You have an earned doctorate.
I do.
Right. And just tell us a little bit about your ministry, too.
Okay. Scholar Ministries was organized in order to help train and teach and pour into those for the sake of worship. How do we develop practically? How do we really use our giftings and our callings to worship?
Wonderful.
How do we really allow the Lord to really grace us with the knowledge and the gifts of how to minister to Him?
Wonderful.
And by employing the gifts that He has given us to do that. How do we make it all one thing? Some of us have giftings and we use it in the secular. How do we use it for the kingdom? The Lord put those gifts in us.
Yes.
Now, gifts are different than callings, but He gave us gifts, and we all should be using our gifts and our callings for the kingdom.
Wonderful.
And so Scholar Ministry seeks to do that and help others develop.
And, you know, you do it really well because last year you had your first annual.
It was the first annual Gathering of Worshipers Conference. And the Lord, even for our first attempt, He met us there powerfully.
It was powerful. It was powerful just to have a convening of different worshipers and the different ways to worship God. And so, Inspired Overflow listeners, those of you that may have just joined in, we're joined in the studio with Dr. Shirleas Washington. She's the founder of Scholar Ministries, and our topic topic today is, how do I worship?
Yes.
Maybe you may have asked God this question. Well, how do I worship you? Is it, you know, waving my hands? Is it crying? Is it singing? Mm-hmm. You know, that this is just something that God had on my heart. And I believe that I'm not the only one that has asked God, how do I worship you? I want to do it really well.
Well, those are acts of worship. Those are the things we do out of our devotion, out of our worship to the Lord. Now, there's a difference between personal worship and corporate worship.
Mm-hmm.
So we, the individuals, we are the church. We are the church. When we come together and we gather corporately, we're coming together, like Scripture says, two or three gathered to worship. We're entering into fellowship together corporately to sing praises, to do all the things that we do, exhort, comfort, edify one another. But our worship is really an individual thing. So how do I worship? And I'm going to throw you for a loop. It's not what everybody thinks.
All right.
The Bible says that we are to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. So what is holiness? Holiness means separation from sin.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he's holy.
Mm-hmm.
And he commanded us to be holy. So we are to worship him in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, his awesomeness, our reverence toward him. All the earth, that's everybody and everything in the earth. So we should not confuse these acts of worship as such as singing, slow songs, or the offerings we give, or volunteering with true worship. Those are acts. Those are the results of our worship and our devotion. So that's just one aspect. We need to make sure that our lives are lining up, that we are constantly seeking to perfect holiness in our lives. That's worship.
Okay. So I just want to make sure that I'm understanding that, you know, because I think a lot of times we think about worship as just like singing songs. I'm going to wave my hands in the air. But I'm hearing you talk about that is the result of.
Those are expressions.
Those are expressions. Okay.
Those are expressions of worship.
And this scripture that you have identified in Psalm 96:9, oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Yes.
Tremble before him all the earth.
Yes.
So live in a sanctified life.
That's it.
Living a sanctified life, holiness.
Those are words we don't hear too often anymore.
Yeah.
Sanctification.
That's a part of worship.
Holiness. That's worship.
Mm-hmm.
That's worship. And then the second point I want to make is that worship is a spiritual discipline. It's a spiritual discipline. So we want to talk about the priority we should be placing on God in our everyday lives, where God is on the list and at the top of that list of our priorities. Okay, so true worship is a matter of the heart expressed through a lifestyle of holiness, which is separation from sin.
Yeah.
See, we should be conforming each and every day, perfecting holiness, perfecting separation from sin till the day we die, conforming to the image of Jesus Christ. That is our worship. And so that talking about the spiritual discipline, let's look at St. John, Gospel of John, chapter 4, verses 23 and 24 says, but the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit. That's with all of our being, everything, our essence, our enthusiastic loyalty, and truth. The Spirit of truth is Jesus Christ. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. See, we were created for this.
Mm-hmm.
We were created to worship. The Bible says that he formed us himself that we might declare his praise. That's why we were made.
Yeah.
And why did he say in Genesis, at the beginning of time, as we know it, let us make man. For what purpose?
Yeah.
We were created to worship him, that we would declare his mighty acts, and that we would declare his praise. And then there is worship is a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. So Genesis 22 and 7, when we think about the time when Abraham was going to offer his son Isaac up for a sacrifice, the Lord said, do it. Now, they had prayed and went through a long time to get Isaac.
Mm-hmm.
But after they got him, the Lord said, give him back to me.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was prophetic. Even in that scripture, Genesis 22 and 7, but Isaac spoke to Abraham. Isaac was the son. Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, "My father." And he said, "Here I am, son." And then Isaac said to him, "Look, there's fire and there's wood. What are those?" The elements of worship. There's fire and there's wood. The things that Abraham brought in order to begin worship, because worship was a burnt offering in the Old Testament. But the son said, "But where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Where is the lamb for the worship?" And so we have to understand that when we worship, there's always going to be a burnt offering. And that's the sacrifice. We are to sacrifice ourselves.
Mm-hmm. I want to ask you, Dr. Shirleas, I've heard you sing, so I know you know how to sing. And I know that you're gifted and you do a lot of great things aside, even from teaching. But just like in your day-to-day life, what does worship look like for you? We talked about that worship is holiness, it's sanctification, it's purity. Worship is a discipline. It's something that we do. It's who we are. Worship is a sacrifice. Just, you know, your day-to-day life, what does, how do you worship God?
Let me get to that.
Okay.
But this next scripture really kind of sets it up.
Okay.
Because King David in 1 Chronicles 21 and 24 said he would not offer God an offering that didn't cost him anything.
Mm-hmm.
So when we're talking about worshiping, we're talking about what it's going to cost you to be a worshiper. I'm talking about being consistent in prayer, consistent with your communion time with the Lord, consistent in the Word, consistent in our devotional time of worship and singing and ministering to Him. That's our worship. So for me on a daily basis, I try and get up every morning early, usually between 3 and 6 a.m. because I'm a fourth watcher. And I'm up and I'm on my face before the Lord.
Yeah.
And the most important thing for me is to be consistent in that. Because when hardship, loss, grief, devastation, trauma, a catastrophe happens, you don't have time to say, "Let me go and pray." Mm-hmm. You have to already have established that connection with the Lord for Him to intervene on your hand. So all you got to do is just call Him.
Mm-hmm.
And He's right there coming to our rescue, a place where we can go and hide and seek His fellowship. That's the cost. Worship going to cost you something. Pushing your plate back, fasting. See, these are old-fashioned things.
Mm-hmm.
But these are things we can't get away from because these are the things that are going to make us mature in the Lord. When we are in service, we should be worshipers who have already in our private time been with the Lord. Because what we do in private shows up in public. So when we come in public, it ought to be fire raining down from heaven.
Yeah.
We should be bombarding because we've already been with Him. We should just be ministering to Him. The atmosphere should be changing. We should be setting up the opportunity for Him to inhabit our praise so that He can step up off of that throne and step down into that praise to manifest Himself with His glory. And glory just simply means it's the manifestation of the perfection of His character. So when He comes into the room, there's no mistake.
Yeah.
There's no, we can feel the weight of His presence in the room. And He comes not only to reveal Himself, but He also comes to commune and speak to us.
Yeah.
We should set up our services where we allow Him in and not push Him out.
You know, and I really feel like just the Spirit of the Lord is saying that He desires to take us into a deeper level of worship with Him. And I really feel like God is like, you know, to just be really unrestricted, to allow God to come in, to allow yourself, you know, to just go deeper into Him in worship. It's like almost like an invitation that I feel that God is extending in this season. And that's why I really wanted to just make room and make space, you know, to have a conversation.
Hallelujah.
For how do we worship God?
How do we
do that in spirit and in truth? And to just kind of get some education.
Yes.
Because I really believe that this is God wants to take churches up higher in worship. He wants to take His people up in worship. And again, it's about worshiping in spirit and truth, not just out of formality, not just out of tradition or culture, but really being able to worship Him in spirit, worshiping Him in the revelation of who He is.
And it shouldn't matter how we do it. See, some people get themselves into groups and tribes and say, we do it like this. And if you don't do it like this, you're not doing it right. But that's not how it is. The Lord uses how he has prepared a people. He uses us in our culture. He uses us in our experiences with him. He uses our singing styles and our worship styles. Those are elements in our acts of worship. That shouldn't matter. Mm-hmm. But we have to get beyond our theology of developing a program, an order of service, three fast songs, two slow songs. Then we're going to have some testimonies, and then we're going to get ready for the most important part of the service. You know, that's the preached word and all that. And we do all of that and never allow Holy Spirit to really come into the place and begin to touch and move the people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, a couple of years ago, we had Apostle Brian Pruitt come on, who's taught on prophetic worship. Mm-hmm. I know the Agape Time Ministries under pastors Pam and John Dillon. They were the first ones to introduce to me the concept of just prophetic worship. I was like, what? Y'all don't have a program? What do you mean?
Right.
You know, what would happen if our churches, if we just said, you know what, we're going to, there's still order, but we're going to allow room for the Holy Spirit.
Well, see, what they have tapped into. What they have tapped into is the understanding that we are still supposed to be worshiping under the style of David when he brought worship into the house of the Lord to begin to minister to him and just invite him in to come in and commune with us and speak to us. So if we've already spent time with him, when we come together, it's time we just want him to come to us as a corporate gathering now and speak to us prophetically. Allow him to speak. We need to be able to hear, not push him out. Mm-hmm. And so that's all it is. It doesn't matter what the style and order of service you do, as long as you don't push him out, as long as you allow him to come in and minister back to the people.
You guys, we're joined in the studio with Dr. Shirleas Washington. Our topic today is, how do I worship? And she's been sharing some points. She shared up to 3 points that we worship God and the beauty of holiness, that worship is a spiritual discipline, that worship is a sacrifice. She has another point, but I guess I want you guys to just hang tight. We're going to take a quick commercial break. And when we come back, we'll hear more from Dr. Shirleas Washington.
Kept telling myself on the last mile.
Ooh, ooh. Hi, my name is Casey Starr Long, host of the Inspired Overflow Radio Show and author of the new book, God, Where Is My Husband? 10 Things to Know While You Wait. God inspired me to write this book to let every single woman that has his heart to know that he has not forgotten about you. I want you to order my book and discover what God has to say to you right in the midst of your singleness. Visit my website and reserve your copy today at www.inspiredoverflow.com.
Tell me where it hurts, and I'll fix it. I am the God that hears.
And welcome back to the Inspired Overflow Radio Show. I'm your host, Casey Starr Long, and we've been having a great conversation today with Dr. Shirleas Washington with Scholar Ministries. The topic for today is called, How Do I Worship? And Dr. Shirleas has been so wonderful, just giving us some key tips on how to worship God, how to worship God, because I believe that God desires to take our worship to another level if we will yield ourselves to him.
Yes.
Before we get back to Dr. Shirleas, there are a couple of announcements that I want to make sure that you guys know about. Now, Apostle Robert Flowers and his wife, Lady Marletta Flowers, they are hosting the Prophets and Personal Prophecy class Friday, January the 25th from 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. And then that next day, Saturday, January the 26th from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Now, this personal prophecy class, it's going to take place at Bate Christian Center, which is located at 695 Graham Road. That's in Florissant, Missouri. Now, your registration is $20, and it includes all of your class materials, and light refreshments will be served that Saturday morning, afternoon. You can contact Apostle Robert Flowers at 314-614-8707 to register for the Prophets and Personal Prophecy class Friday, January the 25th, and Saturday, January the 26th. Also, we got to give a shout out to Haven House, City of Refuge. They are our church sponsor of the month. Okay, the pastor is Michael Folks. The first lady is Phyllis Folks, and we just love them so much. If you're looking for a church home, Haven House, they are inviting you to come worship with them every Sunday at 10:30 a.m., and they are located at 8786 North Broadway. They have Bible studies every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Also, I want to make sure that you know about a brother. He's a church member at my church. His name is Brother Ed Travis, okay? And he is available for all of your life insurance, mortgage protection, and generational wealth building needs. Brother Ed Travis, he serves faithfully at our church, and he is a trusted professional. His goal is to work with you with all of your insurance and financial needs. So if you're looking for someone, you're like, I need a financial planner. I need somebody that I can trust. I want to recommend to you Brother Ed Travis for all of your financial needs. You can contact him at 314-200-4539. Again, that's Ed Travis at 200-4539. Let him know you heard about him on the Inspired Overflow Radio Show. Now, Dr. Shirleas, let's talk again about how do we worship with that final point God gave you.
Well, before we go to that last point, back to worship as a sacrifice. Hebrews 13:15 says, therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. This is a continual process. And I wanted to touch on this because it is very evident. If you're in a service, most of us come out of background experiences where we're praisers. Even culturally, we're praisers. We know how to get it on. Mm-hmm. We know how to praise God, get loud, shout, dance, the whole nine yards. But what we need to understand is that sets the stage for the spirit of worship to come into the place, which sets the stage for the Lord to manifest his presence in our midst. So we enter into his gates with thanksgiving, mm-hmm. and into his courts with praise. Now, after we come in rejoicing, that's how we should come in, rejoicing. Who was it? David in Psalms who said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We should come in rejoicing. I went to a church in Nashville one time. It shocked me like I had never understood before. Well, they started the service. Everybody, they had soft music playing. People were getting into the atmosphere of worship. And when it was time of worship on the dot, they let loose. They just started rejoicing, praising, and dancing. And I went, oh, my God. I had to hold on to my seat because they took this literally.
Yeah.
That we are to enter mm-hmm. with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Mm-hmm. And so all of these, everything we do in the house of the Lord, everything we do, the offering, the singing, everything we do is worship. Those are expressions of worship. But worship in and of itself is a lifestyle. So we're going to finish with worship is a lifestyle. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 says, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. That's worship. And let me tell you about that. That's done in our private, everyday life. Everything we do, we ought to be doing it. When we're washing dishes, we ought to be worshiping. When we're taking care of our kids and going about our everyday life, that's worship. It's all unto the Lord. Everything, we should have a God consciousness. We can be in a service, and as long as the praise is going on, everybody is in that. But when the spirit of worship comes in, you find out who the true worshipers are. Those are the ones that have been with him already. Those are the ones who, when that atmosphere changes, they can just go right in and begin to worship, lift their hands, fall on their faces, bow before him, sing prophetic songs, song of the Lord, whatever the Lord is giving them. If they have prophetic utterances and speaking in tongues and ministering back to him, that's when you find out who the true worshipers are. Because when that begins to take place, when that atmosphere changes, those who are not true worshipers, after the shouting and dancing and stuff, they stand and they look around. And they're not sure what to do. That's how you know who the true worshipers are. So I want to end up with saying, all of that is about our individual, because we the individuals, we're the church. When we come together, we're just gathering as a corporate body. And we're taking it to another level because we're encouraging and exhorting and lifting each up and getting the things we need to help us. Corporate worship, that entering into his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise, that's when we are to usher in his glory. When we're gathered together in that corporate body so that healings and deliverances, salvations, and that curses can be broken, addictions broken off, people can really get set free, and we can hear a word from the Lord, where the gifts can go into operation, the prophetic gifts, the words of knowledge, words of wisdom. That's in the corporate gathering. So I want to leave with this by saying, if your lifestyle does not express the beauty of holiness or the submission to God, in other words, if your life is raggedy, I invite you to make worship a non-negotiable priority in your life. What is that? Praying, seeking the face of God, fasting, studying the Word. Because we worship God because he is God, and that's it. Our devotion of him or to him flows out of the reality that God loved us first. So we thank God for all he has done for us, but our worship is not just acknowledging his blessings. We must focus our worship on his worthiness and not just his wealthiness.
Amen. Amen. Well, you guys have heard directly from Dr. Shirleas Washington. Again, you did it. You did it. You did it. You have shared with us a word from the Lord on how to worship and how to worship God in spirit and in truth. So thank you so much. For those of you that are interested in contacting Dr. Shirleas Washington and learning more about her ministry, you can contact her at Tommy. You can also connect with her on Facebook as well. Yes. Dr. Shirleas, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
I enjoyed.
All right. You guys be blessed. Okay. Until next week, I want you to stay rooted. I want you to stay grounded, and then you will live in the overflow. Until next time, peace out.
You met me deep in my despair to show me you would never leave me there. You claimed me because I was made for so much more. I am your child.